it's time. mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe, 'cause yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. I love this when y'all says, and bodies are still being raised. God, we believe, yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Say, we are here.
Good evening and welcome to Message of Hope from the First Baptist Church of Bayshore. I am Pastor Darius Dixon Clark, and what a pleasure it is and a blessing to be able to come into your homes and give you a word of encouragement and hope in the time of this crisis, the time of this epidemic that is sweeping through our nation. Things are getting better, but we're still separated and isolated and within our homes. And we're just grateful that we have the blessing of this media to be able to come into your homes, into your living rooms, into your kitchens, into your family rooms, into your basements, and be able to bless your lives. We are grateful to you for tuning in to us. We thank you for praying for us, and we want you to know that we are praying for you as well. And we look forward to the day soon where we can all come back together again in this place of worship. But you do understand that the church is within you. And as you look to the hills from which cometh all of your help, and we do the same, we're able to touch and agree in knowing that the God that we serve is supplying all of our needs according to God's riches in glory. Let's pray tonight. God, we thank you and we bless you. We praise you for the privilege that is ours to use this media to come into the lives of the members of First Baptist Church and the members of the First Baptist family extended. We pray even now, Lord God, for everyone that is under the sound of my voice this evening. We pray, God, your blessings and your anointing upon them even now in the name of Jesus. We also lift up our first responders and those on the front line of this battle, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you continue to protect them, continue to bless the nurses, the doctors, the hospital workers, the medical personnel, police and fire personnel, and all, Lord God, who are doing everything that they can, Lord, to make this process a little easier. We lift up our government officials. We lift up the mayor of New York and the governor of the state of New York. We know, Lord God, that you are leading them and guiding them. And in the midst of all type of criticism, Lord God, we pray that you continue to lead them and guide them into all truths. We ask, Lord God, your blessings upon our time together this evening. Remember our church family, Lord, those who are walking through the valley of the shadow of death, those who are sick. We pray, God, that you would continue to bless them and keep them. We thank you and we bless you even now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And all the people of God said, amen. Well, we, again, are excited to be back with you. We had some technical difficulties on Sunday, but we've kind of figured all of those out, and we're back live with you. And tonight, I want to engage in a study with you. We'll take a few weeks to unpack it. Tonight we're going to look mostly at the book of Matthew, but our theme scripture will be coming from Mark chapter 6 and verse number 11. Mark chapter 16, verse 11. There's an interesting statement. It's a very short verse, but it raises a question for us and will be the foundation for our discussion tonight. Again, Mark chapter 16, verse 11, and then we're going to jump into Matthew chapter 28, verses 11 through 17. Okay, so Mark chapter 16, verse 11 says this, "And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. I want to kind of frame our time of discussion tonight and over the next few weeks. Is it fact or fiction? Is it fact or fiction? See, just a couple of weeks ago, we celebrated Resurrection Sunday. Most of the times we refer to it as Easter, but biblically speaking, it's Resurrection Sunday. The day in which biblically Jesus was raised from the dead after his crucifixion and burial on Good Friday. And as I read Matthew chapter 28, verses 11 through 17, the thought that came up in my mind, and maybe it's in yours too, is this question of belief. What do we believe in? I mean, we hear a lot of things. I was listening to the governor yesterday, and he was talking about facts and truth, and in unpacking all of this. No matter what news channel you listen to, there's a whole lot of information out there about the virus and the numbers, and it's plateauing, it's declining, it's all over the place, and it's hard for us to decipher what is fact and what is fiction. Many times in our lives, we hear things that people say. Some of them are facts, some of them are rumors, some of them is hearsay. We're not sure what's real. And so we have to be able to process and decipher things and then gain for ourselves what is fact and what is fiction. Well, I don't think that we're in this thing by ourselves as it relates to sorting through some facts, because as we look at the biblical text, we see this question of fact or fiction. Who do you believe in all of this? And so I want to take the next few weeks and try to unpack this. Today we're going to be looking at Matthew's version, and then we'll proceed to Mark and Luke, and then we'll reach over to John as well. But the foundation of our Christian faith rests on the immutable fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. The truth of the matter is, if there is no resurrection of Jesus, then our salvation is incomplete. Yes, he was born. Yes, he lived for 33 and some years, and he was crucified on Good Friday on a cross outside of Jerusalem, and he died. And all of the historical writers, all of the biblical writers, all of the stories that we hear from the ancient text is that, yes, in fact, Jesus died on the cross. He wasn't unconscious. He died on the cross. And he was taken down by Joseph of Arimathea, taken to a tomb in which he owned, and Jesus was placed there. We also know from biblical history that the Romans put guards in front of the tomb, and they rolled a big stone in front of the tomb to seal it. In some accounts, there was a seal actually put across it, a Roman seal put across it to prove that it was sealed. And those guards were put there to guard the tomb. Okay, so Matthew 28, starting at verse number 1, verses 1 through 11, gives us the account of the women, Mary Magdalene and others. Early in the first day of the week after the Sabbath, they went to the sepulcher. And as they were going, they were reasoning within themselves, who would roll the stone away for us? Who will address the obstacles that will hinder us from getting to Jesus and being able to anoint his body? But once they got there, as they arrived at the tomb, the first thing that they noticed in the dark was that the stone was rolled away. Now, Matthew says to us in the text that as they approached, as they got there, they saw that the stone was rolled away, and there was an angel. An angel had descended from heaven. There was an earthquake. Amen. Angel had descended from heaven and rolled the stone away. And verse 2 of chapter 28 of Matthew says, and the angel sat on it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothes was like white as snow. Right? And verse 4 says, and the guards shook for fear of the angel and became like as dead men. See, there's proof right there that the guards were there guarding the tomb. And the women, as they came, the angel said to them in verse 5, do not fear, do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus, whom was crucified. All right, we go back to the reference of Good Friday that Jesus was in fact crucified and dead, and now he has been buried. He says, I know that you seek Jesus who is crucified. But then verse 6 says, he is not here, for he is risen just as he said. All right, now as we are unpacking fact or fiction, let's deal with the fact that Jesus already predicted that he was going to suffer, that he was going to bleed, that he was going to suffer a cruel death on the cross, die, and be buried. But he told his disciples and those who were following him, he says, listen, don't be discouraged, because I'm going to rise again. I'm going to get up. And that's what the angel is referencing here in verse 6 when he says that he has risen just like he said. And then the angel says, come and see. And so we're going to begin to unpack this evidence, if you will, or facts, if you will. And the first fact is that Jesus has risen from the dead. That's our fact. That's our truth. That's what we're standing on. That's the foundation of our faith. It's the reason why we have hope in the first place and faith in a life that is secure, a life that is free, a life that has been surrendered to God through faith and belief in his son, Jesus Christ. So Jesus has risen from the dead. Here's the report of the women. The women said, this is what they said. They went in and they saw at the angel's direction the place where Jesus had laid or where he was. He's not there now. He says, he is not here, for he is risen, just like he said. Come see the place where he was laying. The New Revised Standard says, come and see where he was laying. Go quickly and tell his disciples he is risen from the dead. And so the report of the women is that, listen, we came to the tomb and Jesus was not there, and we encountered an angel. And the angel said to us, listen, I know why you're here. You're coming to see Jesus who was crucified. Mark says, I know that you seek Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, just like he said. That's their report. That they are eyewitnesses to the fact that his body is not there. At this point, these women are not witnesses to the resurrected Christ. They are only at this point witnesses to the open tomb and the absence of the body of Jesus. Now, if we left it right there, if the story ended right there, that would be their testimony, is that we witnessed firsthand the open tomb. We witnessed firsthand an angel from the Lord, and we witnessed the fact that where his body was, it's not there anymore. And we are witnesses to the fact that the angel said to us that Jesus has risen from the dead. We don't know if the angel saw firsthand the resurrection of Jesus, but the angel's testimony is that come and see where he lay, or where he was laying. He is not here. He is risen from the dead, just like he said he would. And so these women remember and recall and recount the fact that Jesus said that he was going to raise from the dead. And so they have that. But aren't you glad the story didn't end there? Because the angel then tells the women, go quickly and tell Jesus' disciples that he has risen from the dead. Go quickly. And so they leave. In verse 7, it says, go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, here's the proof. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. Verse 7, there you will see him. Behold, I have told you. And so the story doesn't end with just the open tomb. The story doesn't end with the place where he was laying being empty. But the angel says to them, listen, go into Galilee, tell the disciples, and Jesus himself, as a living witness, as proof, is going to meet you there. All right? So it goes, if you will, from speculation of the resurrection to an eyewitness account of the resurrected Jesus. Look, and as they left the tomb in verse 8, quickly with fear and great joy. What a paradox. They had fear and they had great joy at the same time. Fear of the unknown, fear of being caught, but at the same time, great joy over two things. One, that Jesus is risen from the dead, and the possibility that they're going to see him. Because that's what the angel said. Now, that's exciting right there. They're going to see him firsthand and know without a shadow of a doubt that, yes, Jesus had risen from the dead. All right? And as they were going to report it to his disciples, verse 9 says, and behold, watch this, here it is, Jesus met them and greeted them. Wow. So, see, before, all they had was the eyewitness account of the stone being rolled away, eyewitness account of the angel's testimony, and eyewitness account of the fact that the body of Jesus was not there. But now, their report has gone to another level because now, Jesus appears to them and greets them. He greets them, and immediately they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. When they saw him, all right, unlike some of the other passages where when Mary went back and Jesus was there and she thought he was the gardener, she did not recognize him. In this text, according to Matthew, when he greets them, they recognize him. Watch this. They recognize him, and then they take hold of him. They take hold of his feet. They grab his feet, and they begin to worship him. They begin to worship him. They begin to adore him. They begin to recognize his presence. Now, they are eyewitnesses. They're not going on hearsay. They're not saying, listen, we heard that Jesus was risen, but we have seen the risen Lord, and we have taken hold of him. We have worshiped him. We grabbed him by the feet, and we worshiped him. What a powerful report from these women. They worship him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and take word to my brethren, to the disciples, to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me. All right? So just as these women have seen Jesus for themselves, now Jesus is repeating the message of the angel, go, tell the disciples to leave, go to Galilee, there Jesus will meet them. And he will show himself to them. All right? Now, verse 11 of Matthew chapter 28 gives us another perspective. And I want you to look at this. Because not only were the women witnesses to the open tomb and the angel descended from heaven, but the guards who were there as well. Right? It says, when the angel came down, there was a great earthquake, and they rolled the stone away, and the guards that were there shook with fear. Watch this, and collapsed. They fainted. They came as dead men. But now when we get to verse 11, these guards have now woken up. And it says, now while they were on their way, all right, while the women were on their way, some of the guards came into the city and reported to the chief priests all that had happened. Right? The last part of verse 11, you need to circle that they said they reported to the priests all that had happened. Wow. What did they see? What did they report? They reported, if you will, because up until the point where they fainted, they witnessed an angel coming down from heaven. Watch this again, verse 3. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothes was white as snow. Verse 2 says, and behold, a severe earthquake had occurred, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled the stone away and sat on it. All right. And verse 3 talks about his appearance was like lightning and his clothes. Verse 4. And the guards who saw him shook for fear and became as dead men. Right. So they saw him. They witnessed before they collapsed, before they fainted. They saw him. And so they went and told the chief priest everything or all that they had seen, all that they had witnessed for themselves, they went and told to the high priest. All right? Now, can you imagine these guards coming to the chief priest and saying to them, listen, we were given charge to stand outside and guard the tomb of Jesus. And we did that. We fulfilled our responsibility. But while we were doing that, there was a great earthquake because an angel descended from heaven, rolled away the stone, and sat on it. And we collapsed. That's all we could do. We collapsed. We don't know. But when we came to, we came here to tell you what we had seen. All right? Watch this, verse 12. And when they assembled with the elders and consulted together, watch this, they gave them large sum of money to the soldiers. Right? They gave them large sum of money and said to them, listen, this is your story. You are to say his disciples came by night and stole him away while you were sleeping. So while you were laid out, we now have to fill in this piece that you couldn't give us account for because you were out. You don't know what happened after you collapsed. And so the chief priests and the elders filled in the blank. And what they said was, you tell folk that his disciples, the disciples of Jesus, came while y'all were sleeping and stole the body of Jesus, took the body of Jesus away. Now we've got two stories, and the stories conflict each other, because the angel said that Jesus was risen from the dead. The women witnessed that, but the women also witnessed Jesus alive. Now, if the disciples came and took his body away, that would account for an empty tomb. But it would not account for, watch this, alive Jesus. Because they could take his body away, but they couldn't give him life. They couldn't raise him from the dead. Now, they witnessed Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. They witnessed Jesus do some other miracles, but we have no record of them being able to raise anybody from the dead. They were able to heal some people, but again, they were not able, and they had not demonstrated the ability to raise anybody from the dead. Jesus were able to do that, and Jesus did that, all right? But Jesus was dead. And so if we follow the account, or at least the story of the disciples, of the guards, we move from fact to fiction. Because the fact is, an angel came down, as far as they're concerned. An angel came down, there's an earthquake, it rolled a stone away. That's all we know. When we came to, he wasn't there. We don't know what happened. And so for them, now a story, an insert is put in their story. There needs to be an asterisk or a footnote down at the bottom of the page that says, according to the high priest, according to the elders of the church, we're telling you what they told us to tell them, to tell you, but we can't say that because they paid us to lie. Or they told us, they paid us to tell the story in which they started. All right? So their report is twofold. One, they came to the city and they told them everything that had happened. But now they're leaving with a different story, and their different story is his disciples came while we were sleeping and took the body of Jesus away. And then they said, and if it should come to the governor's ear, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble. And they took the money and did as had been instructed. And watch this, verse 15 of Matthew says, and this story, circle story, and this story was widely spread among the Jews, and it is to, as it is to this day. So to this day, some people believe that the disciples came and took the body of Jesus away. Again, that would account for the absence of the body, but would not account for the resurrected Savior or the alive Jesus, which the guards did not see a resurrected Jesus. All right? So we got two reports of the guards. Then lastly this evening, I want to talk about the report of the disciples. Because when the women came to the disciples and told the disciples that Jesus had risen from the dead, watch this, some of them didn't believe them. Right? Isn't that what Matthew, isn't that what Mark tells us? Mark tells us that, now when Jesus, verse 9 of Mark chapter 16, now when Jesus was risen early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. And she went and told them that had been with him, the disciples, and they mourned as they mourned and wept. They were still mourning the death of Jesus. So they were still in death mode. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, watch this, believed not. They didn't believe her. Now, this is a woman who Jesus had delivered from seven demons. All right? He had literally changed her life. He had transformed her life, turned her upside down. And here, because of her faithfulness to him, because of her faithfulness to the ministry, she and some other women go to the tomb early in the morning to worship him, to be able to anoint his body and do what was fitting and what was proper unto him as a deceased Jew, but even more importantly, because he was Jesus. And she not only witnessed the tomb being open, the absence of the body of Jesus, but she also witnessed the appearance of Jesus to her. And so she runs in where the disciples are and says to them, Jesus is alive. He is risen from the dead, and I have seen him. She didn't say, I heard that he was alive. She didn't say, the angel told me he was alive. She says in that passage that I have seen him, that he is alive, and I have seen her, seen him. And they believed her not. So let me at least try to come to the defense of these disciples. Because Matthew also talks about this doubt and unbelief. The Greek word that is there, that is translated for this word doubt, means to waver or caught between two opinions. All right? Or two different stances. They were vacillating between two positions, the Greek word would suggest. Thus, the apostles, all right, are not at a point where they are just being stubbornly disobedient or stubbornly denying the resurrection of Jesus. They're really caught in the human aspect. Yes, they had seen Jesus raise Lazarus, but how could Jesus, who was dead, raise himself? And at that point in the beginning, they had not seen him. But when we go back to Matthew, when we get down to verse 14, right? It says in verse 12, it says, after he had appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the country. So now we're starting to see that Jesus had started to reveal himself unto them in various states. We know he appeared in the upper room with them. All right. But even after they had seen Jesus, there was still this doubt, this unbelief, this wavering in some of them. So some of them got it. Some of them worshiped him. Some of them believed. Some of them believed exactly what he said and believed that Jesus has now risen from the dead. But some of them still doubted. Some of them still wavered. Watch this. It says in verse 14 of Mark chapter 16, verse 14, he says, after he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and he unbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was arisen. And so Jesus basically scolded them and reprimanded them, saying, what do you mean you don't believe? You've seen. You didn't believe the report, but now you've seen. You know the account when Jesus first appeared in the upper room to the disciples. Thomas was not there. And Jesus left. And when Thomas came in and the other brethren, other disciples were telling them, listen, we've seen the Lord. He said, well, I'm not going to believe you. He says, I'm not going to believe you until I put my finger in the print, in the hole in his hand, and put my fist in the hole in the side where the spear was. I need some overwhelming evidence. Just a report that he's not there is not enough for me. A report that the angel rolled a stone away, that's not enough for me. The report of Mary and the others who saw him face to face and worship him, handle him, that's not enough for me. I need to be able to do this myself. And the reality of it is, beloved, for some of us, we're right there in our faith. Some of us, it's hard for us to believe that God's got this coronavirus in his hand. God's got it in control. See, that's where our faith comes from. We've got to be able to stand fast. The Bible says be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. We've got to believe the truth. We got to believe the facts based on the evidence that has presented to us. And I could go into a whole lot of argument about who wrote the Bible and all of these things, and we could go through all of that, but we're going to touch on these accounts. And the accounts are similar, and everybody's got the same story. But they all saw Jesus, and Jesus presented himself in many different ways. All right? So here's some of the possible reasons, and I'm done. Possible reasons for their doubt. First of all, the presence of Jesus himself. Right? Their inability to recognize Jesus when he showed up. Right? When he came in the room without opening the door, they were scared and they perceived that Jesus was a ghost. All right? That would have been fine. That would account for the fact that he had risen from the dead, because now his ghost, his spirit, is walking around. But all of that is dispelled when Jesus, knowing that they thought he was a ghost, said unto them, give me some bread, give me some meat, give me some fish, and let me eat it. Ghosts don't eat food. And so Jesus partakes of the bread, he takes of the fish in their presence. Well, that dispels the fact or the assumption or the thought or the fiction that Jesus is a ghost. He is a person. That Jesus was raised in the flesh. Hallelujah. All right? And the fact that those who were able to touch him proved that he wasn't a ghost. Now, some of the other speculation of the fact that he may have been a ghost was the way that he would appear and disappear. He appeared with two of them as they walked on the road to Emmaus. They spent the whole day with him, talking to him, telling him about him. And then when they get to Emmaus, they beg Jesus to stay with them for the night. They sit down and they have a meal. And Jesus breaks the bread and gives it to them, and immediately they recognize him, and boom, he's gone. Jesus was coming and going over and over again. And so that led for this idea of speculation, or at least caught between two opinions, whatever that other opinion is, about the fact of Jesus in the minds of the disciples, because of, in their mind, this inconsistency of his body. But the fact of the matter is, even if we go back and we look at all of these and we take in account this wavering between positions, looking at the facts, the stone was rolled away by the angel. Everybody testified that there was a being, all right? One of the accounts said that there were two beings in the sepulcher, one at the head and one at the feet where the body of Jesus lay. Again, whether it's one or two, we get the same testimony that the body of Jesus is not here. He is risen from the dead. When Mary encountered Jesus and she said to Jesus, when she thought he was the gardener, she said to him, "If you have taken him away, tell me where you've taken him so that I may go and worship him." Even Mary at that point thought that maybe they relocated the body of Jesus. But in fact, that person that she thought was the gardener was Jesus himself. And when he called her name, something about Jesus calling your name, hallelujah, she recognized him. Hallelujah. So I want to say to you tonight, your faith is rooted and grounded in the fact that Jesus, who was alive, became the Lamb of God, became that ultimate sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, that's mine, yours, and everybody else's, by suffering and bleeding and dying a cruel, embarrassing, shameful death on the cross for the sins of the whole world. They took Jesus down from that cross, put him in a tomb, sealed it. He was there for 3 days from the Passover before the Sabbath, and then early on the first day of the week, the angel came and proclaimed that Jesus was risen from the dead. God raised him up. And the fact that God raised him up is the faith that we have. Because once Jesus is raised from the dead, he completes the process. He has given the sacrifice. He has shed the blood. He has paid the price. He has won for you and for me the victory over sin. Over sin, death, and the grave. The scripture in Paul raises, he says, "Oh death, where is your sting? Oh grave, where is your victory?" Jesus has won for you and for me the victory. And the fact remains that Jesus was raised from the dead gives us the privilege, the access, the opportunity to experience life and life everlasting because God raised him up. That is our testimony. That is the facts. That is our belief. And because Jesus lives, you and I have hope in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of financial crisis, in the midst of whatever's going on in our lives right now. We have hope in this risen Savior because he has promised you and I life. He says to the disciples in John, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." Well, I hope you have been blessed by this word tonight, fact or fiction. I hope that I have answered some questions for you and that the Bible has given you a solid foundation to stand on, the solid foundation of your faith that Jesus, who is both Lord and Christ, was raised from the dead. I want to remind you, as we begin to sign off, we will be on the call-in prayer line. That number will be shown at the end of the broadcast. We've made the corrections to that. You should be able to get in. We look forward to hearing you. Pray for one another. Keep the faith. And we look forward to seeing you Sunday morning right here for a message from First Baptist Church of Bay Shore. God bless you, and may the peace of God cover you and keep you. God bless you. Tonight.
cry face to face. Y'all listen.